Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2022. And the first item on our agenda today is an evidence session for our Scottish Attainment Challenge Inquiry. And this morning we'll take evidence from representatives from local authorities. And I'm delighted to be able to welcome to the committee room Ruth Binks, Director of Education, Communities and Organisational Development at Inverclyde Council. Gerry Lyons, who's Head of Education at Glasgow City Council. Tony McDade, Executive Director of Education Resources, South Lanarkshire Council, and Mark Ratter, Director of Education, East Renfrewshire Council. Good morning to you all. And it is wonderful. I think this is the first time that we've actually had all of our witnesses in the committee room. So you're making a little bit of history for us in this sixth session of the Scottish Parliament. I'd like to thank you for your time today. I'd like to begin with a very straightforward couple of questions, really. We often have heard it said that the additional funds that have come through the Attainment Challenge funding have been used to plug gaps that have arisen because of cuts that would otherwise have had to be made because of the reduction in local government funding from central government. Can I get your reaction to that? Is there a case to be made that that has happened, and is it still happening? Let's just start with Ruth.
From my perspective, no. That hasn't been my experience. We were in at the very beginning of the Attainment Challenge 7 years ago now, and when the money came in to support the local authority, and since then the Attainment Challenge money has been additional, and also the pupil equity funding has come up. It's allowed us to put additionality into the system, I would say. So to look at some of the fantastic initiatives we've taken, for instance, work with the third sector on family support, bringing in additional teachers into the system to target the support where needed, taking teachers out to train them up to become coaching and modelling officers, so that the system can keep self-improving. So you're levelling up the system. So from my perspective, no, the additional money has been additional to the core. It is in a context where we are aware of funding issues in the core. So we have to make sure that the entire system of core funding for schools and the additionality works hand in hand together, because the Attainment Challenge is only a small part of the funding we give to schools. But from my perspective, it is definitely been additionality and a welcomed one.
Teachers, those additional teachers, have they got permanent contracts now?
So the ones who came in at the beginning will have permanent contracts. So basically, whilst they were brought in on temporary contracts to begin with, when they have enough service, they will have transferred to permanent contracts. So we work with, as part of the SNCT terms and conditions, so when they have 2 years service, they will go to a permanent contract. What we've tried to do is keep stability for schools, so that teachers can remain in schools, but we've managed to work the two systems together, the core system and the additionality, to give as many permanent contracts as we possibly can.
Thank you. Gerry, have you been plugging gaps in core funding with...
No, not in my experience. Our approach has always been to take a holistic approach to the funding, and the Scottish Attainment Challenge Fund specifically. We allocated over 80 FTE additional teachers to schools over and above their core staffing, with a view to supporting teachers, developing teachers. It was very much a CPD model, and also supporting targeted groups of young people. We didn't allocate people, we allocated the money for those people then to be released from class to do that additional continuous professional development work with colleagues and support targeted groups of young people. So in terms of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, no, and the Pupil Equity Fund has very much gone to our schools, as was the intent, and we have given head teachers the agency to make decisions about how they allocate that funding, and we've had no intent in plugging any gaps. Core business for us has been the business of the Scottish Attainment Challenge and the business of improving outcomes for our young people. That didn't come to Glasgow in any shape or form differently from where we were. It's always been core business for us. The additional funding was used to develop that core business. But in terms of the full budget for Glasgow City Council Education Services, it's a small percentage. And we very much took a holistic approach, but no.
And used for additionality, Gerry, is that what you're saying?
Yes.
It always has been. Okay.
Yes, and the period of time that the Scottish Attainment Challenge has existed, yeah.
Yeah, that's very clear. Tony, how about South Lanarkshire?
It's similar to Gerry and Ruth, although we weren't part of the Scottish Attainment Challenge Authority Programme. So our PEF, it was principally our PEF, money that was going directly to our schools, and we had 20 schools involved in the SAC Schools Programme as well, which is a grant-claimed activity, so it's a school planning process. The only way they were funded was if they have a plan that relates directly to the funding, so that was all funded towards them. I would reiterate the point as well, we need to use all of the finance that's available to us, not just the SAC activity, if we're really going to try and make a difference around the poverty-related attainment gap. We made an early decision around PEF. It's devolved to schools, but we would put there would be permanent contracts available for teachers, and the reason for that is we recognise that continuity in learning. And we also realise that it's a big workforce. You do get turnover, so you're able to manage that turnover. That's why you were able to put, if staff wanted, or school leaders wanted a teacher, an additional teacher as part of the PEF, we would try to do that as best we can through permanency as opposed to fixed-term contracts.
So let me stay with you, Tony. This is what Greg Dempster, you know Greg Dempster, yeah. This is what he told us, I think maybe it was last week or week before. When the funding in a school or an authority goes down, some of the PEF might not really be additional, depending on our definition of that, clearly. It might be used to prevent a reduction in staffing or in what is offered in the school. A school that is to lose a couple of support staff because of a change in funding or policy in the authority might use PEF to retain those staff because it knows that it needs them to make a difference and that losing them would have a negative impact. Do you recognise anything in what Greg says as bearing out the experience that you have in South Lanarkshire?
In terms of the very specifics, we've had additionality in terms of our school support assistance. I think all of us would recognise the additional pressures around children with additional support needs and trying to support them. So in that very particular example, that's not the case. I can understand the core pressures. I think that's the reality. I think all of us would recognise there are core pressures to our budgets. However, there's been an acute focus for all of us around closing the poverty-related attainment gap. And so therefore, schools may very well prioritise certain things, and when that additional budget has come in, it's been very clear that that's what the money has to be used for. Whether that's been the accountability through schools and how they've been improving outcomes, or indeed for us as a local authority about looking at what schools do. So I would recognise there are pressures, and I think that that's real, but I don't think that one displaces the other. That's not the way in which we've worked with our schools. We've tried to make sure our schools are really clear around SAC and PEF, where the spending should go.
But it could happen. It could have happened in South Lanarkshire.
No. What we're saying is, if I use the example of school support assistance, that's definitely, we have had an increase in school support assistance to try to make sure our children with additional support needs. So the example that he's given, if you're losing two school support assistants...
As an example. Yeah.
What might have happened is that there have been changes in practice. So I would accept that resources have allocated to something and a school continues to do that. And we as a local authority are saying, well, we're looking at a different focus. So I would accept that that would have happened. That could
and
have happened.
The school might decide, oh, no, we disagree with the authority, we're going to keep the staff and we're going to...
Indeed.
So it's not strictly speaking additionality then, is it?
No, it is additionality because you need to look... Things change around your priorities and about making sure that your priorities are focused about the activity. So it's not just about the resource, it's about your priority and your focus and making sure that those staff or those additional resources are used for the purposes of closing the poverty-related attainment gap.
I'm going to give you a break for a minute. I'm going to come to Mark. Willie Rennie wants to come in with a supplementary. I'll make way for him now, and then we'll come to Mark for your answer. It gives you a bit longer to prepare your answer. Willie.
Yes, just to follow up on the step this morning, just on the temporary teachers point, there had been a massive growth, not just through the pandemic, but before that as well. So So I'm curious as to how we can be absolutely sure we're reducing the number of temporary contracts and teachers, because some are going from temporary contract to temporary contract for sometimes up to 6 years. So I'm curious as to why and how we've managed to be so confident that we're reducing the numbers.
The numbers of teachers... We had a bit of a technical hitch there, Willie. Were you talking about the number of teachers on temporary contracts?
Yes.
Yes. How can we be so confident?
That's... I just want to know, how can we be so confident we're reducing the numbers of teachers on temporary contracts when this has been going on for years? Because it said that, you know, it was the additional funding through the pandemic that resulted in a growth of temporary positions. But it was happening for years before that. So how can we be confident that actually it's just not going to come creep back up again in future years?
Tony, we'll come back to you on that, if we might.
They're probably two different things, aren't they? So in terms of the temporary contract activity versus the Scottish Attainment Challenge, although I accept that there's a connection to some extent. For us, it has been about making sure you need to look at your pupil-teacher ratio, you need to look at your workforce planning activity right across around configuration, around numbers of classes versus number of pupils. So that, in a sense, is taken care of. There is a formula that we would work to, and what you're trying to do is to supplement through additionality, such as SAC and PEF, and making sure that there is a degree of permanency. There will always be some degree of temporary nature. We have, for example, area cover teachers, as we would call them, that are permanently based. So we have a permanent contract for our cover teachers. They would cover long-term maternity leaves, long-term absence. But there is a daily paid activity. If you think about it, staff get unwell for a short period of time, and sometimes that's where you would have retired teachers coming in just to cover for a day or two. So for us, you need to look at how you staff your schools on a day-to-day basis. You then need to try to build in workforce planning around cover. That might be those long-term contracts. So for us, those long-term contracts have been around permanency. So we would, beyond schools and class teachers, we would also have an area cover pool that's permanent area cover teachers. We then want to move them into class posts. So therefore, I think it's a pretty complicated picture about how you would manage both temporary into permanent. We, of course, want permanent members of staff. The reality is that that's better for our children and young people. It's also better for our staff. They gain a sense of knowing the community, knowing the children and young people. But there will always be a need for temporary activity, given the nature of the workforce.
So what is the proportion of workforce in your authority that's on a temporary contract today?
I wouldn't have that figure. I can check that figure. I wouldn't have the exact figure. The vast majority, the vast bulk are permanent. And we have, as I say, we have a permanent area cover pool, both in secondary and primary as well, to make sure that we cover absence as well.
OK. Mark, I'm going to come to you now with my original question, and maybe we'll come back to teacher contracts, which you'll discover is a bit of a favourite subject of the committee, because we're a bit exercised by the fact that we have the statistic of 1 in 8 of our teachers on temporary contracts, which we think is outrageous, frankly. Mark, my original question.
Yeah, no, in terms of your original question, convener, we weren't part of the Scottish Attainment Challenge in terms of the wider funding. So we had around about 1.4 million for schools in terms of pupil equity funding. That's absolutely additional in the sense it goes straight to schools. The evidence from them would that they feel very empowered and feel that ownership, that ability. They speak to us about that sort of ability to be creative and take those decisions. So I think that has been welcome. I think that sense of ring-fenced and that accountability that comes alongside that. I would recognise the comments from my colleagues here that for us, that 1.4 million represents just under 2% of schools' devolved budgets. So for us, it's about making sure all the money is making that difference. And I would, I suppose I would recognise that there has been that pressure on the core budgets over the last few years that has meant that priorities at the centre have needed to be very focused. But that additional PEF money is something that the schools have been able to take that ownership of.
And it's additional in the sense that it isn't being used to plug any gaps that have arisen from the core funding, shifting of core funding. or cuts?
It would be similar to South Lanarkshire in that way that, you know, we've had to make difficult decisions in terms of at the centre, you know, whether that's in terms of reductions with the quality improvement team or around educational psychologists. But the schools there have got that ability to make those decisions in terms of their devolved budgets, and, you know, they will they'll focus on the key priorities for them.
One last question from me before I bring in colleagues. Back to Ruth, really, which is, how is Inverclyde going to cope with the slashing of the funding available to you? I mean, you're going to lose 47% of the money that you get currently as a challenge authority. It's going to be gone by 25, 26. How are you going to cope with that? What does it mean for Inverclyde to lose all that money?
So, we always set out knowing that this was not guaranteed funding year upon year with the Scottish Attainment Challenge, and we started off much smaller at the beginning of the Attainment Challenge, and we were always challenged on what was our exit strategy, what was going to be the sustainability for this. The money has gone up to the to 3.2 million in the attainment challenge for us, and if you're asking me if I would like to keep the 2.8 million that we will lose, the answer is yes, I would like to. Bottom line, of course I would. However, I think we have to be pragmatic about this, and we also have to look at different funding models. So In looking at, there is poverty throughout all of Scotland and in every education authority. I think the funding model, the original funding model, did merit revision. We are one of the biggest losers in that revision. So how are we going to do it? So the schools, on top of the attainment challenge funding came the PEF funding. So the schools were given direct money. Some of our initial attainment challenge money was to put money into schools to give them some autonomy. So pupil equity funding came in. Some of our Scottish attainment challenge was funding for summer activities. So we were our literacy lunch clubs. Again, that funding is coming in by other ways. Whole family wellbeing, our proportion, our partnerships with the third sector, that is a worry for us. We have a very good partnership with the third sector that probably we could not keep going, given the amount of money that we will end up with in 24-25. But then there are opportunities for us now to revise how that is looking at working across children's services, looking at whole family wellbeing. So all the things we've taken forward, we're now looking at revisiting and revising. Again, around mental health, looking at employability for parents, all things that were part of our original attainment challenge, which are now being done in slightly different ways. Also, the Regional Improvement Collaborative, if we look at a lot of our early work was done around pedagogy and developing pedagogy. Now we've got a very good improvement in our classroom systems through the Regional Improvement Collaborative, which will do things in a similar way. So there was beginning to overlap in the system, but we have to manage the staffing out of the system. And when we're talking about temporary contracts, that will...
Does it mean people
out of the attainment challenge or into the system. So
are people going to lose their jobs?
No. We're looking at a four-year plan here. So because we will be looking at, we've got the additional teachers that have coming in, recovery teaching, we will have a natural churn in staffing. So we do have some temporary contracts because you can't have such an additionality without bringing in some temporary contracts. You'll have the core system with permanent year-on-year funding will bring temporary jobs in, but we hope to be able to work the teachers back into the system over the 4 years.
You surprised me a little bit because it's almost as if you're saying that you welcome the refresh, which surprises me.
I'm not saying welcome the refresh. I do think it was a fair thing to do. I think we did need to look altruistically across the whole of Scotland. I think when we started as the Chamberlain Challenge authorities, we were very much told that we were the pathfinders here to look at how to make things work, asked to adopt, adapt, abandon initiatives. And we certainly did do that. And it's very helpful to see that a lot of the initiatives that the Early Detainment Challenge authorities took forward in the early days are now being rolled out wider. But I think I started by saying that if I could keep the 2.8 million, I would absolutely welcome that. It is a big cut for Inverclyde, but I think it's one that we always knew could and would happen.
Michael.
Thanks, Camilla. I want to pick up on some of this, the questions here about change to the formula, if that's okay. And the Camilla started off there. So we know at the moment that prior to the pandemic we had, what we were told, was very limited progress against the government's targets on closing the attainment gap, and that's Audit Scotland's words. We know now that we have the largest ever gap in attainment between the richest and the poorest groups after post-pandemic, that gap has grown significantly. And we all recognise the impact of the pandemic on that in terms of the impact it's had on the most deprived communities. So I find it a little bit surprising in that to hear our colleague from Inverclyde talking about what is your exit strategy from this. Surely the exit strategy should be making sure that these kids have better attainment rather than saying, how do we stop spending the money on it? I suppose that's a comment, but I want to explore the rationale a little bit around this. So your reduction in Inverclyde is, by the papers we have in front of us, is 47%. And you are consistently amongst one of the most deprived communities, local authorities in Scotland. Whilst the East Renfrewshire colleague at the other end of the table, consistently one of the most affluent local authorities in Scotland, is up by 43%. And in terms of the papers we have in front of us, in terms of the funding. And then we all recognise, I think, that there is what you might call hidden poverty in every, those figures mask numbers, you know, that there are people in poverty in every community. But do you think we're moving away in this change from a rationale of severe multiple deprivation in communities to something that's more general? I mean, to me, that's been a kind of a founding principle of how we've dealt with poverty in Scotland over a generation, or we've talked about it at the very least. Whether we've dealt with it or not is a different question. But do you think that that rationale has changed? And I'll start with Ruth, if that's okay.
I don't think it has, and I read in the papers the different measures of poverty and using the children in low-income family households is a good measure of poverty. As long as you have a consistent measure of poverty across Scotland, then the money can be targeted at where it's needed most. And remember, although we've had a big cut proportionately, we're a small authority as well, so we have to look at the numbers within the authority as well. When we're looking at the fact that you said the attainment challenge had made very limited progress prior to the pandemic. I think whilst the statistics were perhaps not as where we would have wanted them to be, I think a lot of groundwork was done during that time, looking at the types of holistic family learning that could happen, a lot of the children's services work, looking at the ways authorities deliver education. And certainly what I'm seeing in our schools is the opening up of the boundaries, the partnership working has really flourished, I would say.
Those weren't my words, those were Audit Scotland's words, mm-hmm. in terms of the very limited progress. Mm-hmm. And that groundwork doesn't really make a difference to the kids that have gone through the process now. It may in the future. But the young people who have lost out, whose life chances haven't improved, and also in your own situation, Ms Binks, the young people who are losing over the coming years that resource in terms of the teachers or classroom assistants that are in front of them, that process. So similarly, my colleague Ruth Maguire highlighted last week in North Ayrshire, 60 posts that would be lost. In Dundee, my home city, 100 posts, you know, a 79% cut. So I think we can talk about the longitudinal side of this and experience, but actually for those young people now, these are real cuts, aren't they? That's going to actually affect their experience, isn't it?
The if we look at the totality of the system and the learning that has taken place, I would hope that the experience of our young people will very much benefit from the work that has been done to date with the attainment challenge. And taking into account the pandemic, and we realise that a lot of what we learnt through pre-pandemic was about building relationships, whole family support. We suffered, and Inverclyde suffered badly for attainment during the pandemic, because a lot of what has got us to pre-pandemic wasn't available to us during the pandemic. So I'm seeing a workforce that is skilled up to be able to deal with the young people. I'm seeing a workforce that is imaginative in its use of funding. The schools will still have pupil equity funding. Their ability to manage that funding has grown year upon year to absolutely look at what the evidence is saying and what the impact is. So I'm working with a group of head teachers who are building upon prior learning and optimistic for the young people.
Okay. I'm not sure that answers my questions about the young people now, in terms of those young people who will have left school. Can I ask you one specific question before I come to Mark Ratter? Will you use PEF funding to pay for the cuts to the SAC funding?
As an authority, we won't. What the schools will opt to do might be different. So, for instance, there is the opportunity for schools to use pupil equity funding for something previously SAC might have funded.
Yes. Okay. Mark, the other side of this, your increase is a fairly significant one, although in terms of it's a reasonably as a small authority, a reasonably small number. I think it's up about £2 million, but up 43% across the piece. Could you tell us a little about how you will allocate that money in terms of how you will use that to specifically target young people in poverty?
Yeah, absolutely. I suppose for clarity, the increase is around, by the end of 25-26, is around about 0.6 million. So our PEF funding is going up by 100,000, but that's allocated directly to schools, as we've talked about. And then centrally, in terms of the strategic equity funding, East Renfrewshire will have around, I think it's about 530,000 by the end of the period. I think what we will do is, as you mentioned in your question, we're looking at that holistically alongside our existing approach. We have a very clear vision within East Renfrewshire around everyone achieving through excellent experiences. That funding, 500,000, is very welcome, and it will provide that additionality, but we see it very much alongside the existing money that we have for our children and young people and about making a difference for them. We have a strategy that certainly before COVID was making a difference in our schools. We were seeing the closing of the attainment gap. We talk about raising the bar, so more young people achieving attainment at a higher level, but also closing the gap. So those in a disadvantaged groups, when we look at that through different lenses, we're seeing more of those young people achieving the levels. And I guess we will want to build on our strategy. That's what we're looking at the moment. We're currently consulting. I spent last week in meetings with seven groups of different members of staff as we're gathering their views on how we should be spending that money. But our priorities will be around literacy and numeracy. We've had work over the last few years that's made a real difference in terms of reading recovery and literacy strategies. We want to invest further. The money will allow us to do that in terms of numeracy, particularly in terms of staff expertise around professional learning. I had the opportunity of being part of the inspection process for the Scottish Attainment Challenge, actually, in Glasgow and Inverclyde. And so what we've been able to do is take some of that learning, use the evidence that Education Scotland gathered to inform our own approaches and make sure that we've got those evidence-based approaches in terms of our strategy for numeracy. I think Ruth also mentioned that family learning and that well-being. So that will also be a key element of our strategy over the next 3 to 4 years. We've seen an impact in terms of COVID around children's well-being. I think that's been well kind of trailed nationally, and so that will be part of our work in terms of addressing that holistically. So that probably gives you kind of a flavour of some of the key areas, Mr. Mara.
I find that really useful, Kavir. Can I come to Mr. Lyons, Glasgow, to for a long time one of the most deprived communities in Scotland. Does the shift away from an analysis of multiple deprivation and extreme poverty to something that's more general across the country, does that worry the local authority and yourself personally?
Not really. I would be concerned in a way if there was an understanding that a focus on young people in poverty only started with the Scottish Attainment Challenge. It was heightened by the Scottish Attainment Challenge, but I've been in Glasgow for well over 20 years, and it's always been a focus of us to improve outcomes for young people in poverty. So for Glasgow, the Scottish Attainment Challenge sits within Glasgow's Improvement Challenge, which is about improving outcomes for all of our young people, and especially improving outcomes where the gaps are. And I suppose, Mr. Mara, one of my points there would be the gaps are not all. So we've got a school with 95% SIMD 1 and 2. Therefore, we need to just improve everyone in that school. But there's a more sophisticated process goes on where we start to say, so where are the other gaps that appear? And I think we've got much better at that. So dealing with this issue for Glasgow has been core business. We've made very significant strides. I would also pick up a couple of points about additionality. We will continue to focus on doing the best for all of our young people and closing the gaps that we identify for those young people that need that extra push, and we will continue to work with our schools in order to do that. Additionality is also present in our schools in terms of capacity. Our teachers are better. Our staff are better. They understand the issues better than they did because of our investment in them and because of the work that's been done both by the local authority and the schools in partnership. So I don't see a move away from trying to do better for young people in poverty. From a Glasgow perspective, that will never happen. We will never move away from that because it's so vitally important to us. And working with colleagues here, we're all focused on that. We always have been. I think we're more acutely focused on it now. We're now sitting here and having the conversation. So I think that's a really good thing. And I agreed with what Mel Ainscoe said, that there is a greater clarity about this issue than there was. There is a greater crystallising of this issue than there was. I think it lacks a wee bit of ambition to think that's enough, because actually what has happened is there's a greater understanding about what it takes to respond to it. There's a greater understanding of how you implement that and the range of interventions that it takes. And that, I think, is vitally important. And there is a COVID frustration around it, if that's the right phrase, in the sense that, you know, in Glasgow, we had closed the gap by 3.5 percentage points in just under 3 years in both literacy and numeracy. And then COVID came along and you're then having a different issue. But one of my concerns in all of this is, yeah, that's in literacy and numeracy. How do we recognise the gap is closing? In our Duke of Edinburgh Awards, in SIMD 1 and 2, we had an increase of 524% of our young people gained the Duke of Edinburgh Award. It gets no recognition in this debate, and it should. So I think we've got to look more widely at what it means, but certainly from a Glasgow perspective, there is no exit because there was no entry. We were already there and we will continue to be there.
My last, if I can, Convener, just to Mr. McDade, I don't want to leave you out. And I suppose my question to you then, you may have followed up some of the evidence we had previously with colleagues from trade unions in front of us recently who described this shift as immoral, that they were aghast in terms of the shift in the funding formula. It's totally unacceptable in their view. How would your council, South Lanarkshire Council, your funding's up 8%, how do you think you would cope with a cut of 79%? Because a former head teacher from Dundee told us they didn't know how they would cope. How would you see it? Is that? Would you be able to cope with that?
I think that's challenging. I mean, let's be honest, I think, as Ruth has described, I would probably say it depends on the kinds of programmes and activities. I think one of the crucial points is that PEF continues, and the PEF money is directly to schools based on FME, and that does give schools leverage. That does give schools an opportunity.
It's from SAC.
Well, no, not necessarily, because some of those SAC, I'm now speaking about some of the SAC challenge activity that we've not been involved in, but some of the SAC, because we've worked closely together, some of that SAC challenge activity was based around family learning and whole school activity, and also some centralised activity within the local authority. So you can look at some of the other budgets to be able to do that. The thing I would also say is, for us, and maybe just projecting forward around the change, so we were involved, the bulk of our money continues to be around PEF. We were involved in the SAC schools programme, so 20 of our schools were given some additional funding beyond our PEF. Now, we wouldn't have picked those 20 schools necessarily. Those schools were picked around a particular profile, but that didn't take into account rural poverty. That didn't take into account concentration of poverty in a couple of our schools as well. So the bulk of the money still goes through PEF, but the Strategic Equity Fund, which is about just over £2 million for us, we'll be able to redirect that to a more concerted activity around 124 primary schools, or indeed across our 20 secondary schools as well. So you're able to try to take some of the learning that have happened with the schools. And there's obviously a support of the 20 schools for the next period of time as well, and some of the work that they're doing. But the benefit collectively to some of our other schools now around the Strategic Equity Fund does help us. But my final point is, some of our schools in our rural schools don't really get any PEF, but there is rural poverty. And one of our work streams sits around rural poverty, and the Strategic Equity Fund will allow us to just redirect some of that resourcing.
And that redirection from parts of the country where there is huge deprivation, significant challenges to those young people who are in poverty, is not a case that we're seeing those kids in some of the poorest communities paying the price to help the kids who are in rural poverty. Is it right that we have that trade-off, one for the other?
It's not an either-or, is it? I mean,
some of those children, it is. Let's face that, it is.
But for us, in terms, just to be clear around the kinds of support that we're given, what we're trying to do is to make sure that we do address those issues of rural poverty. That's what some of that Strategic Equity Fund does.
Should indeed absolutely happen, but not at the cost of. We'll maybe not agree on this. Thanks, Convener.
Ruth.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Good morning. Thanks for being here. Finding this morning's session really interesting. The Convener and I and some other colleagues met with parents from some of your local authorities last week and had some direct feedback from their perspective about how the different initiatives had helped their children. We heard of how access to Nurture Hub had helped, you know, one girl sustain her attendance at school. Also heard good examples of really dignified support being provided to parents really in need. So it was good to hear that feedback from the folk who really know what's going on, I suppose, as they're supporting their children. I was interested in what Gerry Lyons said about the local authorities and teachers always being focused on poverty, and I think that's absolutely the case. Even from before this, I've seen in my own local authority head teachers and teachers doing things to help children break down those barriers to sustain school. But I do want to ask a bit about the culture change that SAC has brought on. Gerry, you spoke about the additional learning for professionals that's been helpful. I wonder if you could talk a bit more about that for me.
Yes, absolutely. And it's an important culture change, because I think it made explicit something that we were all kind of working away at. And it led to very direct engagement around the issue, probably more widely. In terms of some of the features of that, I suppose, one of the things that we've recognised over the period of time is that there is no one thing that's going to help, that's going to make the difference here. It's got to be a whole matrix of activity, a jigsaw of activity, if you like, to make the difference. And the culture has been, we're understanding that range of activity better now. So it's not a case of just improve learning and teaching and everything will be better. If you don't improve learning and teaching, things will never be better, but Yes, that's part of it. Understanding poverty, understanding the impact of poverty, we know that's really important, and there's been a lot of professional development around that. Supporting families, nurture, and support for families is an entitlement. It's not something we do just because we want to be nice to people. They're entitled to that support. So again, we understand what family support should look like better than we did. We understand what in-school support should look like better than we did. So nurture, for example, has grown and evolved and developed. Support for young people with additional support needs has grown and evolved and developed. So the culture is made up of lots of different activity. The other thing I would highlight is it's allowed a much closer partnership working with community groups who in many ways understand this better than we do. And we have benefited hugely both from those groups working directly with their families, directly with their parents and their young people, but also working alongside their staff and letting their staff understand it from their perspective. So all of those things come together, bring a cultural focus on this, which has been really, really positive. The other thing that I think is, I notice, and it's observable, the improved dialogue that I'm having with head teachers and head teachers are having with their staff about, so what about Ruth Maguire in your class who's here but probably should be there? What are we going to do about that? And they just understand that the systems are better, the dialogue's better, it's more focused, and they now recognise that at times you do have to target. You can't just always do, you know, we want to be universally effective, but sometimes within that universal effectiveness you need targeted intervention. And Glasgow has an approach of targeted intervention groups emerging from better use of data so that we get the intervention to the young people who need it most and then can look at what difference has that made. So hopefully that answers your question in the sense that culture is made up of a lot of different features, and all of those features have improved as a result, not necessarily just of the funding, but of the agenda. Does that make sense?
Thank you. Yes, that's helpful. And I think one of the key things I took from our session with the parents was that they sort of repeatedly articulated through what they were telling us that their families were understood and it was understood what they needed. And I think that was a very big thing.
Just for one second, that understanding of families has meant getting out to them more than them coming into us. And also, COVID did help that. We'd are really interested, and if I can just give one wee example of a parent in a school that was one of the recovery visits saying, do you know, Mr. Lyons, see when you've said to a head teacher that you've run out of toilet roll, and she gives you toilet roll, you don't worry too much about coming up and asking them how your boy's getting on. And I think it's that wider engagement which has been really, really powerful and which we will now build on and capitalise on, and it will accelerate progress. I'm absolutely convinced by that.
Thank you, that's helpful. The parents that we spoke with were from East Renfrewshire and South Lanarkshire, so maybe come to Mark first for your reflections on that culture change and then to Tony.
Absolutely. I mean, I think I would probably recognise and many of the changes that Gerry has just spoke about, probably ones that I would maybe add. I think there's been a real focus in terms of that leadership, both at that strategic level, so schools really building that in to their sort of vision, values and aims, and you spoke a little bit about that, building those leadership skills of their staff at all levels. So to make sure there's that real focus on addressing poverty, supporting families well, and I think particularly in terms of learning and teaching, I don't think we can underestimate the difference that makes. Gerry spoke about that earlier in terms of the numbers of children and young people in deciles 1 and 2. We would say that although we've got very different profile, actually if we can improve the quality of learning and teaching for all the children in a particular class, then that culture change is enormous. So it's been that very much that investment in pedagogy. And I guess the other thing, rather than just repeat anything that Gerry has said, I suppose there's been a real investment in an upskilling of the way schools and teachers and the system uses data. And I think that has been something that we've learnt from one another. There has been a real focus on tracking individual children and young people, just as Gerry was talking about, looking at the groups, making sure staff can drill down in that way. Do I think we're there yet? No, not at all. And, you know, some of the points in the paper, which maybe we'll come on to, I think in terms of that culture, we're still trying to share that. And as somebody involved with ADES and somebody that's chairing at the moment the Performance and Improvement Network, we are constantly working to see if we can share those approaches that local authorities have got and that schools have got that is working well to make sure that that's continuing to improve the culture further.
Thank you. Tony.
Thanks. Probably just building on what has been said as well, I think there has been a huge focus on the cost of the school day. I think the work of things like the Child Poverty Action Group has had a huge impact on all of us, and making sure that schools are really sensitive and have an ambition around making sure that families and children and young people are supported in their readiness to learn. And it's not just about their young people and their attainment, isn't it? It's about poverty of opportunity. So making sure that poverty of opportunity is not there, that we take away those barriers and where we can about extracurricular activity, the residential experience, the curricular costs. Those are really essential. If we're genuinely, and I think we're all clear around that activity and that mission about making sure our children from backgrounds of deprivation have the greatest opportunities and there's not a barrier that stops them, I think that has been a game changer within schools. I think that our schools understanding, I spoke with some children yesterday from a primary school, P6s and P7s, and I asked them about costs of residential activity or their uniforms. They said the same thing. We know if it was too much for us, then we could go to the school and we could say. And I was asking them, would you be confident enough to do that? But of course, that's built around relationship. It's built around a sensitivity of staff being fully aware and actually knowing the individual children. I also think it's a concerted effort. Schools can't do this by themselves. I think lots of people have said that into the committee. But this is about council. It's about access to benefit. It's about making sure that families have a decent housing environment. It's about access to our social work department where necessary as well. We need to make sure that all of those are aligned and that families are confident that they can access that support and a bit of additional help if that's required for them.
Ruth, I'm not leaving you out. Do you have anything you want to say? I suppose in terms of culture as well, there's the bit about more autonomy for schools and teachers and that working together, collaboration with community groups and things like that.
100%, and absolutely agreeing with all my colleagues. We've seen a huge maturing of that, whereas head teachers who were aware of the issues are now more able or feel more empowered to be able to help. And I think the one thing that's struck me is head teachers feel are not alone. You know, teachers feel a huge burden upon schools, and it's not something that schools can solve by themselves. And I think over the last few years, we've seen that expand. And I have to say, during the pandemic, the opportunity to work with partners, absolutely, it was one of the positive things that will keep going. Head teachers saying to parents, what will help? You know, and being actually able to feel empowered to put something in that will help the individual families. There's not one size fits all, but what will make a difference to your life? You know, that those sorts of dialogues. Also, something we've seen is parents helping other parents. When we're talking about cultures, talking about things like uniform banks, where parents have been empowered by the school to help each other. We've got some wonderful examples where parents have bought in the college to do employability courses in the schools. So somewhere where people feel safe and welcomed, and head teachers have been able to facilitate that. So I think they've been able to use their imagination, certainly their information, and also to look wider and develop those partnerships.
It's helpful.
Willie Rennie.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I think that was a really helpful explanation as to how the system has evolved, and I think the two bits that I particularly take away is the listening and the understanding and they're reaching beyond the school gates into the family home. I think that's a significant change. I know, I mean, this committee often looks at challenges and barriers because we want to make the system better. I've got two particular issues I want to raise. One is about, you know, school leaders, head teachers, are central to making this work. But we've seen quite a shortage of head teachers in recent years, including the emergence of more joint headships in some areas. And I'm just wondering whether that poses a challenge to the further improvement of this system. And secondly, are we able to get the right expertise when it's available for the needs of the variety of pupils that we're trying to assist? Is the specialisms there, are the specialisms there to assist the schools in meeting those needs?
Jerry, you were a superhead, weren't you? Not Superman, superhead, interchangeable. Maybe you could start with the head teacher thing.
Yeah, I'm not sure I recognise that characterisation of it, convener, but yeah, I did have responsibility.
Tabloid press speak, that was.
It was the press and the journalist, and I have had a conversation about it ever since. The quality of head teachers and the number of head teachers, and we have had some challenges in recruiting head teachers. Mr. Rennie, you're right. To me, that's step one, and one of the most important things we can do is put quality people into our schools and into head teacher posts. In Glasgow, we've had over 50 newly appointed head teachers who have never run a school when there wasn't COVID. They've never done it. So there's a capacity building issue there for head teachers. And the empowerment agenda for head teachers is different depending on where you are. So for those head teachers, we need to grow their ability to manage their own empowerment. How do they make good decisions? How do they work closely with the local authority in the right way? How do they strategically plan? And how do they grow other leaders? And I think that's a really important point. So your first point about numbers of head teachers is, yes, we want to encourage more people to become head teachers. Yes, there's been some challenges around the legislative requirement for anti-headship, which is right. We should want highly qualified people. But there's just, for me, been a bit of a time lag between people getting their anti-headship and being ready to take on posts, and then the number of people that we need. So there's just a bit of work to be done there to improve on that. But then we need to grow them. And I look at my, you know, our 140 primary heads or 30 secondary heads, and there are a range of readiness for what they need to do, and that's okay. So what we are very keen on is a key leadership strategy, develop people. If they don't feel ready to be empowered as we need them to be, what do they need? What's the continuous professional development? What's the leadership strategy to help us to do that? And how do we move the compass so that they see themselves as the key decision makers in the local authority? So in short, the answer is, it is a bit challenging at the moment, but it's about the quality of the people and then what we do once they're in post to help them get better. In terms of the expertise, I think there's huge expertise in this country. I think we should explore more how we partner with academic institutions, with our higher education colleagues, working more closely in partnership. The OECD did pick up the issue about using research more effectively, but some of the best expertise is right there in our schools, between our schools, within our regional improvement collaboratives. And one of the things that we've seen, and I would want us to recognise as something we should continue to grow, is let's use the best of who we have. Let's identify the best practices in the system and be strategic in how we share that, and by doing that, grow all of our people. So I think the expertise is there among our communities, and we are making those connections more effectively. We could work in a different way sometimes with our universities, and I think that's certainly worth exploring. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you.
Willie, where do you want to go now? To Ruth?
No, I'm fine. That's me. I'm happy. Yeah.
Did that answer both of your points? Did you have you had 2 points?
Yeah, it did.
Okay,
yeah.
That's great. Just as a supplementary to Willie's question then, Gerry, you mentioned key leadership strategy. What do you do for these head teachers, these new head teachers, to help them feel empowered as leaders? What do you do for them?
Yep. In the same way as I answered Ms. Maguire's question, we don't just do one thing. So we have a very detailed induction programme for those head teachers. We, as part of Glasgow's Improvement Challenge, we have a leadership workstream, and we have regular sessions with our head teachers, which will become more regular now that we can actually get them into a building together and working together. So we have targeted sessions on, you know, Mark referred to managing data, on understanding intervention, on how you plan growing your community, all of those leadership areas. I kind of split it up, convener, into two things. We grow their technical understanding. So they need to understand the curriculum. They need to understand learning and teaching. They need to understand assessment and moderation at the level they're at. They've got a good understanding already, but how do we grow that? And then the leadership, relationships, working with the local authority, working with parents and families. So we do that through formal programmes. We do that through sessions where they work together. We do that through working with colleagues in the Regional Improvement Collaborative as part of that leadership strategy. And then we get into their schools. So the challenge team go to all of our new head teachers and sit with them with their data, with their systems, and with where they think they are with their young people, and support them in how they plan based on where they are. And again, it's that matrix of activity that grows people. And we want that relationship to be clear. We want the other thing we encourage is make decisions. Don't feel as though someone's going to judge you on those decisions. We will support you. We will help you. And you know what? Sometimes you're going to get it wrong. Did anybody ever tell you when you were a head teacher that you were never going to make a mistake? Yeah, of course you'll make mistakes. Fine. Let's learn from them and let's grow. The hardest year of my career was my first year as a head teacher, but I got better. You know, not to the point I was super convenient.
Well, that's
that,
not what it says.
But I got better.
That's not what it says in the Glasgow Herald. And that
I completely get. And I think we all want that for all of our head teachers, for them to continue to grow and get better. And essentially, the best schools are led by the best head teachers.
I think because Willie's right. I mean, one of the things that I think is dawned on a lot of us in this committee is the leadership calibre of these head teachers is the critical factor in the performance of a whole range of indicators. And we hear amazing. We had some amazing stories during the time that we were interacting with teachers and with parents. And I think the committee probably would be interested to know a lot more about the leadership development programmes that are being used and successfully deployed and the effect of those programmes. So I think that's a subject we want to come back to. Supplementary from Michael, and then I think we go to Graham.
Yeah, it's a slight risk of a tangent on this, the headship stuff. I think it is very important to how the attainment challenge work is governed and run. And we have... we talked about the numbers, but there's some data published, I think, in TESS recently about the number of deputes or others who, and a significant decline in the number of people who would want to actually be a head teacher. So you've talked about the work that's done with head teachers. Why are people less attracted to doing the job than they were previously? Tony's got his hand up, please.
Yeah. Thanks. I think it's challenging. I think the reality is if you layer the last 2 years of the work for some of our head teachers. We were at our head teachers meetings recently and I said that our head teachers have proven that they can do anything. I mean, quite remarkable the activity they've done over the past 2 years. They can't do everything all of the time. And I think we have to be realistic about the kind of workload that we put on our head teacher, that there's a longevity to it as well, that we need to make sure that when we're asking about priorities, that we are sensitive that there is a long game to them. We're not looking immediately and saying you must sort that by tomorrow. Gerry's quite right as well. For all of us that have been involved in a school environment, you need breathing space. You need the ability to go up and to be confident that people who lead the authority will be sympathetic to that and we'll make sure that you're in the right direction. I also think as well that we need to try to continue to encourage our principal teachers, our school leaders, our deputy head teachers that are aspiring, and making sure they do see the worth of the job. The job is a tremendous job, but the reality is that it is demanding. I think the trick in that is to make sure that those head teachers know that they're not making those decisions in isolation. There's a support mechanism for them, whether that be through colleagues, because that's often through peer head teacher groups, whether that be a learning network that comes formally, whether the local authority, the RIC, those are the kinds of activities, because then people feel it's manageable. I think the thing is, you need to feel that you're in control, you know your local community, you're in control and you understand that, but at the same time that you're not a permanent feeling of being overwhelmed, that you need to make sure that you know where you can go and that there's a manageable workload with an aspiration, but there's a realism attached.
Has grown then in recent years, given that there's been a decline in the number of people who are aspiring to headship. Is that something you would recognise?
We've been fortunate. We've had our applications to our jobs. Some of it is rural in nature to us as well. But if I just take in our urban areas, we've not had as much of an issue. I think the past 2 years have been challenging. I think we have to recognise that. If we don't, we can't set that aside. I think if you look and people were working with our public health, all of us were working with our public health colleagues, the demands on schools around bubbles and are around isolation was just extraordinary. I think we're seeing some of that just now.
Okay. Thanks, Convener.
Graham.
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, the committee's inquiry is looking at how effectively the funding streams, specifically aimed at tackling the attainment issue, are being deployed. But I want to explore the potential impact of one or two other Scottish Government initiatives. Ruth Binks talked earlier about the groundwork having been done. I want to look at the impact of physical infrastructure as well, because we are now in a position where 91.6% of pupils are being educated in settings that are deemed to be in good or even better condition. On the back of a joint work by the Scottish Government and councils to refurbish and rebuild schools since 2007. And I wonder about the extent to which that has created a foundation for us to help tackle the attainment challenge, because I was struck ahead of this session when I was looking for perhaps examples of where schools had flourished, and there were a couple in particular, Kilmacombe Primary School in Inverclyde, which on the back of a refurbishment won a Raising Attainment and Literacy Award. And we've also seen some quite remarkable figures at Eastwood High School in Glasgow, where the percentage of pupils getting five or more hires increased from, I think it was 17% to 40%. So I just want to explore with you the extent to which refurbishing the school infrastructure, the buildings, is also going to help us to take us forward the challenge that we face. And perhaps start with Ruth Binks, as I've name-checked her.
Okay. I'm an incredibly unfortunate position, and every school in Inverclyde has either been fully refurbished or is a brand new school. And the school estate in Inverclyde and the early years estate is phenomenal. Does that make a difference for the young people? Yes, it does. The young people come into buildings which are high-class buildings, and it gives a sense of pride for the whole community in education. So absolutely. I have to say we work with the architects. We've got some architects in Inverclyde who have looked into Frobelian ways of working. So they're very imaginative. They work alongside the school community saying, what will work? What breakout rooms do you need? What will your curriculum look like? And of course, as the curriculum adapts, we've got schools that perhaps we would like to go back and revisit. But absolutely, the infrastructure, giving that sense of pride and the place, absolutely works. But a school building is only as good as the community that is in it. So it does not replace that at all. It will not replace high quality teachers. I've worked in some buildings which were awful. We had buckets for the roof, and by goodness, those teachers were brilliant as well.
Yeah. Do you want to make Dave?
Again, we're very fortunate. Predates 2007, the investment in South Lanarkshire. We're in all of our children and young people are either in complete new builds or they've been refurbished completely, and that would include our earlier settings as well. And we absolutely see that pride, we would recognise that, and it does help a learning environment. You have breakout spaces, they're bright, they're airy. I would also say as well, there's no greater investment, I probably would say this, there's no greater investment than driving into a community in the new building is the school. That's a sense of all of us investing in our children and young people. So we definitely see it. Whether it's correlation and causation, you know, I think there's a sophistication in that, but it's definitely better for our children and young people. We needed to replace our buildings. They were unfit in many instances. What I would say, though, is because we've been fortunate as a local authority and that money has been invested, that doesn't mean if you're in another local authority and your building's not quite up to speed, there's not some remarkable learning taking place, because there is some remarkable learning taking place. The buildings definitely help, though.
That lot, but I mean, what we're seeing, certainly in my neck of the woods, is the development of community campuses. So the school building isn't Monday to Friday, 9 to 5, if you like, and then it shuts. It's actually available to the community, whether it's leisure facilities, whatever. And that model most surely assists some of these communities to develop. Gerry?
Yeah. If I can just rewind just a wee bit, if that's okay, and pick up the important things about ethos and value and honouring our young people and our staff. And I think you're right. I think all of that's important in isolation. In terms of Lomas community centres, absolutely. You heard parents talking about, you know, being in schools, learning. In a range of schools in Glasgow, we have parent learning programmes. And if parents want to better themselves, they go to their school to do that. And the community campus allows them to do that. For our community groups, for our sports clubs, for all of those things, we want our schools to be the hub of activity in their local communities, because when they are that, people feel part of them, and when people feel part of them, they get the best of them. So yes, absolutely, the community hub development is welcome, and we encourage it, and we run lots of summer schools, you know, festivals at different times during the school year when young people are not in school, but it keeps them involved, it keeps them occupied. And, you know, school holidays aren't always idyllic for every young person, but if you can get into your school with a partner and you get something to eat and you do really interesting things, our schools are allowing us to do that. And I would only pick up one other point, which my colleagues, just to add to what my colleagues have said, is we are also able to use our building to improve the curricular offer. So in a whole range of ways in our schools, you know, we have barista training, we have vocational centres, we have working offices, we have working construction centres in our schools. Not that I've been anywhere near it, and I refuse to go anywhere near it, we do have beekeeping in a number of schools in the East End of Glasgow, where our young people have their own beehives and are, you know, making honey. We have a microforest in one of the schools. So it goes wider than just the building. It goes to the whole area, mm-hmm. and what opportunities that can give young people and the local community. Because some of that outdoor education is being delivered by parents, and they're coming in and helping and doing mm-hmm. their bit. Yeah. So all of that works around a well-designed facility, but supported by strong leadership, yeah. strong people working within it.
OK, that's fine. And maybe just to finish, convener Mark Ratter, because I think Barrhead High School was another school that had quite a remarkable improvement on the back of a refurb.
Yeah, both of those schools that you referred to, Mr. Day, Eastwood High School and Barrhead High School, are both within East Renfrewshire, both fairly recently refurbished. And I think, just as colleagues have said, that those new buildings and wider facilities have made a real difference in terms of that whole school ethos. And I think also that around that ambition. We found NFER did some research that tracks through and looks at, you know, what are the factors that make the biggest difference in terms of supporting disadvantaged children and young people's achievement. And if you pick up the whole school ethos and ambition, that's two of the seven factors that they see as critical. And we've spoken about some of the others this morning around learning and teaching. And I think a new building can also facilitate that. So within those two buildings that you talked about, I think perhaps just to emphasise the vocational aspects. So those buildings have got fabulous facilities in terms of sort of home economics. They can do barista training, fabulous facilities in terms of physical activity. So I know within Eastwood High School, they saw a huge increase in the number of children registered for free school meals, taking part in their wider extracurricular activities, and they were using their PEF specifically to support that, but the new facilities that they had were enabling that to happen. So I think, you know, it's that holistic approach as well as attainment that you referred to.
I mean, just to be clear, I wasn't in any way suggesting that this was the most important thing, as opposed to the ethos of the school and the quality of the teaching. Far from it. I saw it as being complementary to the work that's been done.
Totally agree.
Yeah, thank you very much,
Convener. Thank you, Graham. Co-cap, Stuart. Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener. I've been absolutely fascinated and hooked by everything that's been said here. A lot of that resonates with the evidence that I took from head teachers a couple of weeks ago from the area, the West Area Partnership, so I'll come into that. I want to talk a little bit about collective agency, which obviously is part of that renewed mission. And I, for one, having worked in the field for many years and sometimes schools in the past over decades, I think have felt a bit isolated. And I'm glad to see now that schools are being recognised as part of the picture to address the poverty challenge, and that there has to be a multi-agency approach. So that is absolutely fantastic to see. So regarding sort of that kind of collective agency between government that sets policies, local authorities that implement those policies, and then working with third sector organisations and community partners as well. Could you give me a little bit of a flavour of, within your own authorities, what kind of success stories and what also hasn't gone so well? What challenges have you faced in sort of having that more sort of like, you know, working with partner agencies? I think we'll pick up with Mark first, please.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I think for this one, the starting point for me is around that sort of empowered approach in terms of that collective agency. It's something that within East Renfrewshire that has been part of our culture, I think, certainly well before the PEF funding that we had. It's very much an approach of working in partnership with our head teachers. So them very much having that ownership of that improvement agenda, of providing the conditions and the facilities and the support for them in order to lead that improvement. And certainly when we speak to our head teachers, they feel that sense of ownership. They feel that the quality improvement team and the team at the centre act as that critical friend, supporting in terms of that. And I suppose it's very much that partnership approach around, to give an example, taking the areas that they would identify as areas that they want to prioritise and for improvement. So if we take something like numeracy, that's coming through in the discussions with our schools as an area that they want to address coming out of COVID, then the authority then supporting them in terms of that professional learning and investment for the staff. That's then much more effective and efficient in terms of that approach. Also very much in terms of the curriculum, I think the schools need to have that ownership of the curriculum, with teachers making the decisions on the curriculum for the children and young people in front of them in that way. And that's the approach we've taken within East Renfrewshire. And I suppose that brings you into the other part of your question around that collective agency and that link with sort of third sector or other partners. And if you were to come to East Renfrewshire and go and speak to the different schools, as you got a little bit of a flavour of, you would get that sense that each school is meeting the needs of the young people that they've got in front of them and making sure there's that relevance to the curriculum in terms of the young people that they have.
So they're basically able to, they're empowered enough and confident enough and supported enough to be able to respond to the very bespoke needs sometimes of their local school communities. I mean, that did actually, I have to say, a couple of the head teachers at that session, I did ask them the question, did they feel supported by the local authorities to be able to make quite difficult decisions, you know, with sort of competing demands and priorities? And I have to say they did. They did feel supported. So I thought that, you know, it's worth passing that on to you. Celebrate the successes. Jerry, do you have anything to add to what Mark has said?
Yes, I do, and some of my experience is exactly the same as Mark's. Our position is definitely that Glasgow's so diverse, you know that, you know, that what works in one community will not work in another community, and the people who understand that best are the people who work in the community. So our partnership with our head teachers is very much saying, right, well, there's a direction of travel, there's what we want to achieve for our young people. But in your area and in your context, how are you going to do that? And then providing the appropriate support for each school. And you'll know yourself, they need different things at different times, and that's okay. So we want to provide that. All of our schools would tell you that they cannot do this alone. They've got no desire to do it alone. And they see their partners as not an external but part of their school community and part of the people that they work very closely with. And I think that's good. And again, we give them the agency to go and make those connections and work with those people and plan together. So that works well. Agency goes beyond the head of the school, and some of our most effective people are our teachers, support for learning workers, DYW coordinators, all of those other people in the schools who wrap around the children, really, really importantly. And we do have some outstanding partner agencies and people working with them. In terms of a wee challenge in there, and you said, you know, what hadn't worked, early on, people found that what they thought they would get from a partner agency was not necessarily what they got. And that's where you need to be brave and say, look, this isn't working. Can we change it? Can we tweak it? Can we get better at it? So there was a bit of that. And we are growing in our understanding of how you show the impact of that work. And that's always been very important for us to say, right, that's all well and good in terms of there's that activity, that activity, that activity. But what has that actually meant for the young people in poverty? And our schools are getting much better at that, having, I would say, needed that development from early on in the challenge. But again, partnership working precluded that in Glasgow.
Thank you. Ruth, did you want to add something?
Just perhaps building on the partnership working, at the beginning of the attainment challenge, we had an implementation group. And one of the wonderful things about that group was it wasn't just head teachers. It was libraries, third sector, social work. And actually the cross-fertilisation of ideas was very exciting. So so our head teachers could take ideas maybe from the libraries and say, OK, we're going to explore that. So and it's giving them the ability to develop that and actually for them to come back and discuss it with others as well. So constantly reflect. I would say also that the partnership working again through COVID, where people have had to work together to take things forward, has been fantastic. We've got 6 head teachers who, knowing their different circumstances, have been able to work as a group and feed back to us, here's what we think will work. And that's been a very exciting environment to work in.
I suppose that what I'm thinking of there, what you've made me think of, is that then there's consistency within a local authority or within learning clusters. But the challenge then is the variation across 32 local authorities across Scotland. So that's the dilemma in my head that I'm grappling with, is that you have you know, that collective agency, you also have the empowerment agenda, but how do you then ensure consistency across the whole of Scotland? So that, you know, if anybody can chip in once Tony's sort of come in with my previous bit.
Thanks. I'll maybe try and take them both.
to me, and I thought I'll just throw that in before I forget.
Maybe in the first point, it's really about schools and individual teachers knowing their own story around their children and young people and their school community. and been really conscious about that strategic priority. I think having a collective priority around excellence and equity, I think then people completely understand that. I also think really importantly, and it has been touched upon, about the agency of the teacher. It's within a parameter though, isn't it? It's about making sure, and maybe that answers the latter part of your question as well, it has to be a strategic direction. None of us are saying that it's just a free-for-all. I don't think teachers would want that as well. I think teachers and school leaders would want to feel supported, and there's a genuine direction that comes from that. I think then it's about the kinds of support. Teacher empowerment is about knowing as an individual teacher where I can go to for the support, whether that be the technical support in the curriculum, whether that be pastoral support and around supporting a young person, or indeed supporting around additional support needs and staged intervention, so that the support mechanisms are clear. Is it the support within the school? Is it within the learning community, as you rightly say, or indeed the local authority, the regional improvement collaborative? Maybe just touching on that, a success story of that is that I would look at it from a West Partnership perspective. We put in West Online Schools, there was a request early in lockdown about the digital offer for our children and young people, and making sure, and that was from our leaders and from our teachers as well. And we, Gerry led on the West OS activity, but basically a set of pre-recorded lessons teachers put together that we were able just to try to strategically look at. And so for this year, even in this session, we've had 98% of our secondary schools use that. We've had over 90% of our primary schools. Even last night, I saw some tweets about West to West maths because of the National Five and Higher exams. And that was taken up. That wasn't just teachers within the West Partnership. That was supported nationally as part of the digital offer. So that collective agency, that came from teachers saying, we're really worried about the digital offer, and that was one way in which we could do it. I suppose very specifically, we need to be clear about the outcomes, don't we? To answer your question, the second part of your question, we need to be clear about what are the measures that we're looking at. Is it the NIF measures? Are we looking at longitudinal activity? Are we looking at PISA? Or are we looking at the global competence that goes beyond simply around the attainment measures? We have lots of data in the country. The question is, what are the measures that are important to us that help us measure the gap? But also, I spoke earlier about the kinds of opportunity for young people. I do think it's important we try to measure that. We do see it in Duke of Edinburgh. We do see it in lots of the other vocational courses and the skills that young people develop. We need a way of capturing that as well.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Tony. Did anybody want to come back in on my second bit? Mark?
Maybe just to pick up a little bit around the theme around consistency. Obviously, it's a key point from sort of Audit Scotland around the variation, but also when you follow that through, as you mentioned there, Vice Convener, around the consistency argument. And actually, it's interesting, their recommendations that they set out in that report. I mean, they had three around that: one for local authorities, which was around using data to understand the trends more effectively, and then using evidence-based quality improvement approaches. And sharing that learning and practice. And the third one was working with schools, as we've just been exploring. And I think on those first two, within ADIS, we've taken a lead on that. We see that as, you know, it is important. We need that ambition. We need to be doing more around consistency and variation. And we've developed in partnership with Education Scotland what we've called a collaborative improvement model, which is at its heart, it's about sharing that effective practice. It's bringing together Education Scotland colleagues, it's bringing colleagues from across ADES together to support a local authority with an area that they've identified as needing improvement. So the ownership still sits with the local authority and the schools. There's still that empowered approach. It's based on their self-evaluation, but it is then supporting that improvement. So as somebody that's just recently gone through that model, we had a focus on numeracy and maths and where there are strategy that we'd had that was just put in place just before COVID was making a difference. So were we seeing improved attainment in maths? Were we closing the equity gap in terms of maths? And we were improving experiences for the children and young people in our classrooms. And I have to say, it was a really robust, challenging process with colleagues from Renfrewshire, South Lanarkshire involved. We had colleagues from Orkney, as well as HMI inspectors, Education Scotland, all looking at our data, looking at the evidence that we'd gathered, taking part in that, and then helping us shape those recommendations. So to me, that's one of the ways where, you know, that supports that understanding of the trends and the data, but also supports that sharing of practice across the system. And, it, you know, just maybe for noting for the committee, All of the local authorities across Scotland have signed up to be part of that over a three-year period, and by this summer there'll be 11 that have taken part. So I think that's a positive step that we've taken as local authorities.
That is really welcome. Thank you for letting us know that. Did anybody else want to come in before Jerry?
Just had one wee thing. The collaborative improvement was what I was going to mention as well, Vice Convener, but I suppose the only bit I would add to that would be from that then comes a connection where there's support for that local authority in taking forward their action plan from other local authorities. So I was involved in Fife and left an open offer to say, if you're looking at X, Y and Z, Glasgow's got a lot of people who are, you know, have made really strong developments in there, and we're more than happy to provide that support. So the collaborative improvement process itself is robust, it's helping each other improve, but then the follow-up is where we work together to bring about that improvement to lead to greater consistency.
And can I just ask a practical question? How do you sort of monitor that, and how often do you meet together? I mean, is this something that happens sort of infrequently, or is it regularly in the calendar? Is it embedded in your practice? That's what I'm getting at.
So it's in its early stages. The intention is that it will become embedded in our practice, and we would want it to become embedded in our practice because we, in our days, we believe that we can all help each other be better. And the way the process works at the moment is there's a pretty intensive 2-3 day programme depending on the area of focus, and that gives a detailed report, and it is a pretty robust process, and there's an openness about it that I think is really positive, where, you know, Mark owns it. So Mark's saying, look, I want to know where it's working, where it's not working, and then as colleagues we're quite happy to say, you need to have a look at that, or you need to have a look at the next thing. So it's in its early stages. The sign-up's brilliant. The people who have been involved have found it a really positive experience. And I think it will grow from there to become a core approach, not just at local authority level, but we would hope more and more at school level as well.
Thank you. Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Ross.
Thank you. I'd very much like to follow up this line. I'm interested in your approach to making sure that we're getting really robust evaluation, making sure that the money is being spent on initiatives that are actually effective without putting such an administrative burden on schools that they've got staff who spend more time evaluating programmes than actually delivering better outcomes for young people. And maybe start with Ruth on your approach to that, given Inverclyde's the length of time that you've been a challenge authority. You've probably developed quite a coherent approach by this stage.
So, and yes, you're absolutely right. You don't want to create a bureaucracy of this. That's going to take away from the day job. And it's about intelligent use of data and intelligent support and challenge as well. Making sure that what's been put in is actually we're seeing that transfer into the outcomes for young people. So we've done it in a variety of ways. We've built teams together. We've had head teachers challenging each other. The head teachers were very open to sharing the data and actually to sharing their improvement journey as well. And so rather than one person going into a school and supporting and challenging, actually we've had teams around people, not dissimilar to the way the ADES is working. So I think the culture we've developed of mutual trust has been absolutely imperative to making this right. There are some things that just haven't stuck, you know, some things that haven't worked. We've been fortunate to have a very good attainment advisor who again has been working with the with our schools, and she uses the term adopt, adapt, abandon. You know, where if the schools are not seeing the bang for the buck, as they would say, they will actually change tack or stop the project. As an authority, We look at we absolutely track the data. We have 3 or 4 data points during the year, and we do all that work for the schools. So basically, we're using CMIS. So when the teachers are putting in their data, we can then churn the data and actually help them and support them with that. And then we have what is almost a jointly written pack to look at the interventions. But I think the key to our success, and we have been successful, is the culture in which we've worked in. So when we're asking head teachers for any information, they see the value of that information as it comes back. We've also been putting in regular reports to the Scottish Government through the attainment challenge. I've got one in front of me, and they are comprehensive. We've kind of always challenged ourselves in anything we put in there has got to have a meaning. You know, is it taking us forward? What difference has that made? It's also been able for us to be able to take a reflection point and say, OK, so have we increased the number of families we're working with, for instance, with the third sector? Have we seen that go down? Has the attendance really stuck? So it's allowed us as a team to work together. And then you look at the attainment challenge authorities, where we've challenged each other as well. So actually, not dissimilar to ADIS, where we've been able to share practice and to be able to really be open and honest about what we have seen has worked, and what we would lie down in the ground to keep. I would say the one thing our head teachers would say they'd lie down in the ground to keep is our data support team. They find that work having been done for them in the culture of mutual trust has absolutely been for them a really supportive mechanism. So hopefully that's answered your question.
That was really useful, particularly the point you made there about essentially schools shouldn't be afraid to try something and fail. The nature of this means that we should be encouraging that kind of innovation, and we've certainly heard evidence in the past of a reticence to take a risk and fail is resulting in a lack of innovation. But if they're being encouraged to say, you know what, this is an acceptable risk, the local authority is not going to come down on you for quote-unquote wasting money, I think that's really healthy. And if I could ask Tony just exactly that same question about how you go about it as an authority who's previously not been a challenge authority, but you have had some relevant funds and we're now moving to this new model, what approach you'll be taking there?
And I suppose that's a good point, and maybe important for us that it's aligned to our school improvement planning process. It shouldn't be two separate processes. So, because ultimately you're looking at strategic priorities from the school itself to the local authority and then to the national priority. You hope that needs to be aligned, that we're not that we're not asking schools, again, your point about being overly bureaucratic in this. We want our teachers and our school support assistants to be leading on those interventions. We want to lead on an evidence-based activity. We would have a similar approach to data, for example, in which we would look at some of the data activity of that school, help produce it for the school, and so that they don't need to then go through tranches of activity around data. We then have a coaching model in which those head teachers can come together. They lead on many aspects of the delivery of the work that they've been doing. They will come and then they will look at an evidence-based approach. It might be a small test of change, and we would then have them as an equity team. They would come, or equity leads within our schools will come, and they will specifically look at some of the interventions. They would then look at the evidence behind that, and we would then try to scale some of that activity out. So we try to look at it both centrally as a local authority and then indeed into the schools and vice versa. Also from a regional improvement collaborative, we would do the same as well. We have head teacher networks that specifically look to try to support our colleagues and schools with a focus around equity as well. I think it's just making sure that those avenues are there and being really clear that this is not additional. This is lined up mainly through the school improvement planning process, and that strategic priority is clear for all of us.
Thanks. If I can move this on slightly, or maybe come to yourself, Mark, on this point. It would be impossible for us as a committee to scrutinise in detail what every local authority and every school is spending this money on. And we shouldn't do that, because every local authority has its own elected representatives who are responsible for scrutiny at that local level. So I wonder if you could maybe give us an example of what does that look like in East Renfrewshire? What kind of reports are you preparing for councillors? What scrutiny is provided at that level?
Absolutely. I mean, if we take a sort of annual sort of cycle, we would, at the start of the year, take to our education committee our local improvement plan. That would be part of that consultation process, taking elected members' views and then also parents, head teachers and so on as you're forming the plan. We would also then take, at the end of the year, the standards and quality report, which would exactly as Tony was saying, we wouldn't sort of separate the two. We would make sure that there was clear evidence of the progress in terms of closing the attainment gap and raising attainment more widely related to our strategic priorities. But what we've also done, I think, because of the, to make sure there is that clear accountability, we took pre-COVID a regular report in terms of the pupil equity funding and the progress that our schools were making around that 1.4 million. I felt it was important that elected members were able to see the difference that it was making and also that it was a way of sharing that practice. And we also took a regular report on the National Improvement Framework and on the progress that we were making with those four, at the time, four priorities, and now going forward, the five priorities. So over the year, then, that would give elected members that kind of clear picture of the progress that our schools were doing. And we supplement that with sort of a range of presentations so that, again, they're able to understand some of the difference that it might make in that specific context of individual schools and so on, and really try and bring some of that to light, I suppose, as colleagues this morning have talked about when they've been meeting with parents and head teachers and teachers.
Thanks. And finally, Gerry, I wonder if you could comment a bit on some of the new guidance that's come out recently around providing annual reports on how the money's spent for parent two parent councils, for example. I think on one level, that provides a really healthy level of not local scrutiny, but accountability and engagement. But there's perhaps a danger that it creates false expectations that you can, within the space of a year, do something totally transformational on what are really embedded societal problems. How are you planning in Glasgow going about getting that balance right of giving parent councils information that they deserve to have, but getting the expectations right around what that means in terms of annual reporting?
Yeah, absolutely. And the way you've characterised that is really helpful, actually. We would always, and right from the very start of the Scottish Attainment Challenge, we did expect our head teachers to report to their parent councils and to their parent group about the work they were doing. I would probably say to you that there's a process before that, which is a process of consultation and discussion about how are we going to allocate the funding, what are we going to do, what difference do we hope it makes. So if you take it almost as a cyclical approach in Glasgow, that parents and parent groups and parent councils and parent focus groups are involved, as are young people, and right, this is the money, this is what we think we're going to do, is there anything you would like us to do that we're not planned on, and get views, then regular updates on how things are going, and then that kind of gathering at the end. And I'm very comfortable with that, because I think it's important that parents feel engaged, and if they don't, I think we're getting it wrong. And I think our head teachers want that level of engagement with them. So I want that cyclical approach. I want our parents to be involved. But I suppose it goes back to something that Mark said and probably has characterised. Different parent groups will need different kinds of support and will want different kinds of information. Head teachers know that better. Head teachers are the ones that work with those people. And therefore, it's for head teachers to say, right, for this group, that's the right information to give them. For that group, it's not, and we'll give them something different. But I think if you take a cyclical approach to it, where they're involved at the start and at the end, you get away from that. Well, what do you mean you've only done X, Y, and Z? To, yeah, we knew that's what we were trying to achieve. How have we done that, and what happens next?
Excellent. Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Ross. Stephanie.
Thank you very much, Convener. It's been fantastic, actually, to hear from you all today. And certainly my experience has been, when we've been out and we've been speaking to head teachers, etc., as well, there, that they've been really confident in their own expertise. You know, they've talked really enthusiastically about the work that they're doing, the positive work they're doing, and how they can build on it. And I can say as well, I've also seen at parent councils, just at my own children's parent councils, for example, that real shift into talking about wellbeing all the time. It's not anymore, it's not about, you know, going on a little school trip there or doing the school fair. It's really, really central. And the cost of the school day report that was mentioned earlier by the Child Poverty Action Group, I think, has been massive in that, the toolkit that they gave parent councils. So it was just to really mention that there. Now, I found it really interesting the way that you've been talking about, you know, the initial funding, allowing that exploration, laying the groundwork, being able to trial all different approaches, to learn from them, to produce the evidence on them, to be able to measure them better there. And I'm really interested particularly in how local authorities are measuring progress with health and wellbeing. So I appreciate that on the ground within our schools, it's very, very clear the improvements that it's making to our children and young people. But it's about, you know, how do we actually measure that on the ground? How do we make sure that those measurements are cutting across different schools, different local authority areas, and then at a national level, so that when we're looking at things as well, you know, we can look at, are we investing money in the right places here? What is it that we need? How do we make sure that we're giving this every support that we can? And if I can start perhaps with, Ruth and Jerry, first of all, since you guys were part of it, and then bring in Tony and Mark. Thanks.
So health and wellbeing is a huge priority and always has been in Inverclyde, just because we realise that if the children are not ready to learn or in a state to learn, then they're not going to learn. So actually, you've got to get that right first. It's a difficult one to track because young people in their own mental health or health and wellbeing will have different stages. So it's not as easy as saying you've passed an exam. So it's a journey for everybody, and everybody will be at a different point in the journey. What the types of things we've looked at. We've had a big focus on attendance in Inverclyde because we have a gap, a poverty-related attainment gap in attendance. And actually in Inverclyde, our attendance was lower than we would like it to be. So we just asked the question, why would that be? What is stopping young people coming to school? Which leads us on to a lot of the inputs we've put into mental health, I would have to say. If we look at then the inputs and the capacity, and I'll start with mental health and perhaps go wider. I think that's been one where our teachers, our young people, our parents, us as school leaders, and especially coming out of the pandemic, having a huge focus on the inputs we can give to young people for mental health. And it's got to be a suite of inputs as well. So we're looking at whole family community health, mental health, different inputs at different times, knowing that those relationships with the teachers themselves are very important to our young people. It's not always about having another counsellor in a school. I was at an Easter school the other day, and there was one of our home and economics teachers was just putting the soup into the wee pot to put into the freezer, and there was two young boys just talking away to her about their expectations, and it was just a lovely session to listen to. So it's that relationship and building the capacity of our teachers to be able to deal with the health and wellbeing of our young people. We also need to look at the whole family health and wellbeing as well. Certainly through our work with Barnardo's, when we're looking at families that are sometimes quite stressed, attendance was sometimes lower because the family was hitting a difficult time, and actually it wasn't the young person's mental health, but it was perhaps mum's mental health that was stopping the attendance. So a lot of work around holistic support for mental health and wellbeing. We also have asked our schools to look at the ranges of activities on offer, and to look at particularly attendance. We have we've doubled our input for Duke of Edinburgh coming out of the pandemic, because we want the young people to be out there. We want them to have those experiences that they've missed. But we do track the people who are attending that, making sure it's not just the same people lots of times, and actually it's across the board. So our schools are increasingly becoming good at looking at the inputs they have for different types of health and wellbeing initiatives, for instance, after school clubs, but also looking at the attendance, and they're now beginning to look at perhaps the young people who are not attending anything, and then to put in bespoke opportunities for those.
Okay. Yep. So Glasgow, from Glasgow's improvement challenge, had a focus on health and wellbeing and the development of health and wellbeing. Some of the ways that we can see that we've had positive impact, every year our sports team have gathered statistics of increased participation in sports clubs and schools, and they produce a lovely infographic on the numbers that are taking part, what they're taking part in, and the increase over a period of time. So that's been very positive. Our nurture programmes have supported young people with those attachment issues to be in school and to feel safe in school. And that's not about a base, that's about a nurturing environment and nurturing principles, and Glasgow's had huge success in that. We've reduced exclusion since 2015. The percentage of primary pupils has been excluded has dropped by 59.1%, and for secondary pupils a drop of 58.3%, and there's been an 87% reduction in exclusion. So our young people are spending more time in school, and that's a good thing. The mental health challenges are significant, and more significant since COVID, and I think it's really important that we focus on promoting positive mental health, promoting well-being, rather than reacting to poor mental health and poor well-being, although we need to do that effectively. So, you know, positive programmes, nurture, train staff as mental health first aiders. We've got mental health first aiders trained across all of our schools. The counselling input has been really, really important, but has also helped people improve their own capacity. So that's important as well. The diet, the breakfast clubs, and feeding our young people and make sure they're ready to work has been very effective. And lots of our schools have run classes for parents on how to cook well on a budget, which is just so practical, but really, really important. So all of those things, I think, are there and are happening. I suppose one of the things that I would raise is, as we move forward, is I think there is room for us to do some very targeted research on what would a set of indicators for mental health be that we can all agree and that we can all find a way, maybe measuring isn't the right word, but of exemplifying. And I don't think we've got that across the country yet. I don't think attendance and exclusion is sufficient. So what does that look like, and what evidence can we provide to show that our young people are developing in their well-being and growing in terms of mental health and all aspects of their health? So I think there is something to be done there.
Thank you.
That's probably just building on what Gerry and Ruth have said as well, that we would look at some of those similar activities. I'm acutely aware that schools will look at uptake into activity, so beyond the classroom, how are young people engaging in the extra offer, and I do think that becomes incredibly important. There are obviously, maybe from the national perspective, we do have the Healthy Living Survey. That Healthy Living Survey will look at free school meal uptake and the offer around physical education and physical activity. Are we looking at the 2 periods and 2 hours, which is the ambition that's set with that? So we collect that data on a yearly basis. Obviously, we have the Growing Up in Scotland Survey. That Growing Up in Scotland survey, and that again looks at physical and mental health and wellbeing, childcare, education and employment, involvement in offending and risky behaviour. So some really important things that Growing Up in Scotland survey will give us and already helps us direct around, for example, speech and language as well, development, especially in the early years and around early intervention activity. And also for us, some of the activity around motivational behaviour. So we're trying to find a way of how do you measure pupil engagement. That's quite tricky. I think that sits with the young person. I think that sits with the pupil and the young person and how you manage to, how they self-report and what's their expectation of their own wellbeing and making sure. So that's, I think that's done very, very well at school level. The difficulty, is, as Gerry said, is translating that into a consistent national picture.
Thank you. I should perhaps mention actually that I'm currently a councillor at South Lanarkshire Council on my very last day today, so I should probably mention that. Thanks, Mark.
Maybe just to add to what colleagues have said, I suppose it's getting that balance between those local measures that schools will use that will, you know, provide that very rich picture of the health and well-being of the children in their school, and then that sort of system level data. And that's probably the bit that, as Gerry's saying, there's fewer consistent measures. So obviously we make, like others, use of attendance. We also sample all our schools with a sort of questionnaire where, again, we've built in some of those themes into that. So, you know, it'll ask the children whether the school is supporting them and helping them become more confident. So it picks up some of the sort of, I guess, wider purposes of education, going back to the sort of four capacities, which I think is important. And so that gives us a sample across East Renfrewshire. But again, it wouldn't be consistent across all 32 local authorities. It's back to that kind of theme we were looking at earlier. And I suppose the other measure that I would kind of see as probably important or related to this would be around the sort of participation measure or school leaver destinations. Because although that's not strictly speaking about health and wellbeing, I do think it gives you a good indication of the curriculum that has been provided and whether that curriculum is meeting the children's needs and enabling them to go on successfully post-school in that way.
That's great. Thanks very much. I'm aware of time, so I will pause there.
Thank you, Stephanie. And Bob Doris.
Thank you, Convener. Really important line of question from Councillor Callaghan for a day, anyway. And I suppose is the final contributor from the committee. I'd like to take a step back and look at some of the evidence we've received so far over the last few sessions. So Angela Bradley from the IS told us we should look at achievement as much as attainment. Jim Thewlis told us that he would suggest that attainment is too narrow a focus. And in that context, we measure what we measure. And I might start with Mr. Lyons, being a Glasgow MSP, wanting to give some Glasgow data, get Mr. Lyons' reflections on that. But then if the other witnesses could come in, convener, and maybe flesh out what their experience is in their area. So, Mr. Lyons, first of all, in Glasgow, congratulations, 3.5% reduction in 3 years, improvement rather than 3 years for literacy and numeracy is a great achievement. But there's other indicators which I think I'd be interested to know your views on what we should capture routinely across the country as part of the attainment challenge and what we shouldn't. So, for example, in Glasgow, positive destinations for school leavers was 96.3%, record levels in Glasgow, above the Scottish average. And I should point out, Convener, St Rocks and my constituency we visited, every young person had a positive destination, an area that certainly knows what deprivation looks like. I'm sure you'll agree, Mr Lyons. We also saw, Convener, it's important to put this on the record in this context, that 71% of young people in Glasgow went into higher and further education. In fact, with record levels of entrance into higher education in Glasgow. So there are two things that, as politicians, have a debate about. Are we addressing the attainment challenge sufficiently? We look at literacy and numeracy, as absolutely important as that is. I'm just wondering if we need an agreeable dashboard of measures that we all just take a step back, Mr Lyons, and say, let's chart this as well to see how successful this attainment challenge has been. And I should reflect one final bit of evidence, Convener, and that was the teachers from the West Partnership that we met at St Rocks Secondary also said they wanted to make sure we acknowledge, that we celebrate and we champion the excellent achievement that's already taking place, because sometimes that's lost within the political debate. So, Mr Lyons, what would that dashboard of success look like? What measures would you like to see, and any reflections on what I've just said, and we'll bring in other witnesses after that?
Yep. So, great to end on a Glasgow MSP. talking all the data, so that was brilliant. I agree with you. I think we need a wider dashboard of measures. And I think I would like us to use the measures that we have in a more sophisticated way than we currently do. I think we should continue to look at attainment measures. My view would be that I would like those attainment measures to be published and analysed as young people leave school, not at the different staging points along. So let's focus on exit. So where are young people at the end of their school journey? So I would like a greater focus on that. And I would also like to see within the attainment context that the discussion about how we assess young people, how we they get a chance to show their learning and show their levels of attainment, which has already been discussed. I don't think there's a more important discussion in Scottish education at the moment than that one. And I would hope we could be much more creative in how we allow young people to demonstrate their learning and demonstrate their attainment. So I would like the attainment measures to continue, but I would like to see them at exit point. I would like to see the way we assess to change so that young people can show their learning in a range of different ways. I would like us to be continue to focus on literacy and numeracy because it's such a foundational skill. But actually, and I think our primaries do suffer from this a wee bit, that we also celebrate attainment across all curricular areas. And I know that's incredibly difficult to do well, but let's not minimise attainment in the arts and in STEM and in technologies. Some of our schools do brilliant work on that, but they don't get the credit because maybe literacy and numeracy is still not quite where it would be. So wider basket of measures, particularly in primary schools. I agree with both the other two contributors you referred to, that we should have a celebration of achievement and that part of the dashboard should be achievement. Again, I think we need to do a bit of work on, well, what does that mean? Does that mean you celebrate a number of kids that get Duke of Edinburgh or John Muir Award or whatever? Or do you look at it more roundly than that? So I think we should have achievement. I think we should absolutely have a great focus on positive destinations and continuing focus on positive destinations, because that's actually a big bit of the future look. And, you know, in that destination figure that you developed for Glasgow, within the most deprived areas of Glasgow, that quintile, 97% of young people in that SIMD 1 and 2 went on to a positive destination. So there's something there that should be celebrated, and you have celebrated it today, so thank you for that. So for me, achievement, attainment, positive destinations, some way of celebrating health and wellbeing, but I'm not sure what that looks like, and I do think we should commission someone to get that right. And the last bit I completely agree with. There is so much excellent work going on in Scottish education. There is so much brilliant work being done by our schools, by our staff and by our communities. Let's get that out there front and use that as the basis for improvement rather than what sometimes is the case, which is that we find the things that aren't working and spend all our time talking about them because we miss so much by doing that. Does that answer your question?
And a bit after that as well, Mr. Lyons. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
I should put on the record the attainment challenge started in 2015 and PEF started in 2017. So, convener, when I mention positive destinations, that's not just good work from the teachers looking at that cohort as they leave school. That's work done by teachers over a number of years that the attainment challenge has been running. We shouldn't miss that out as well.
Absolutely, and things that might be worth looking at actually is you don't get positive destinations if you don't have a really good 3-18 journey. So the work of our early year centres, the work of our primary schools are part of the celebration of positive destinations. And is there something about how we show the development of young people and their career readiness, if that's the right word, and make that part of the dashboard of measures as well? Please don't come back and say, how do we do that? Because I'll have to say, no sure.
We'll be upset because we're running out of time. Other witnesses will want to give their story from their local authority as well. Thank you very much, Gerry Lyons. Very helpful. Ruth Binks.
Just to build on what Gerry's saying, absolutely looking at the leavers and the journey up to the leaving date, making sure that we're looking at the positive destinations, the participation measures. In Inverclyde, we know what happens to all of our young people, so we have 100% of our known destinations, so we don't let anybody slip through the net, and that's important to us because if somebody's not in a positive destination, we want to know what happened, what could we have done better, but also what can we do to support beyond school. Absolutely think about the celebration of the talent within the school and what the teachers do on top of the literacy and numeracy day job. Each of those teachers nurtures the talents and brings out the absolute gifts our young people have. And, you know, the tennis players, the football players, the musicians, the actors, they're all in our schools at the moment. And actually, we're developing them. And it's that rich curriculum that helps that. So nothing much to add to Gerry.
I'm conscious that it might be reflected across all four witnesses. Anything you'd like to add to a dashboard of achievement that we can monitor over a period of time would be welcome. Any response? Tony McDade?
I do think we obviously do have the attainment measures around the NIF and the National Improvement Framework, and those measures are there. You know, there are 11 measures, and they do help us with literacy and numeracy, and they definitely help us look at that gap. I would agree about wider attainment. I think we've got better at it. If you look at, we've now not just basing our evidence at senior school level as pupils leave around the number of hires. We're able to look at SCQF levels and look at comparable work. I do think we need to extend that to look at the range, whether it be, obviously we can look at foundation apprenticeships, but lots of young people will maybe look at a training provider or a college activity. I think that should be part of the suite of measures of activity that we look at. That's really crucial. I also think we need to be careful that we try to measure everything and then suddenly it's not of worth to us. It's about what currency as well for that young person. We talk a lot about the capacities. I think within the original move of Curriculum for Excellence, we spoke about a pupil profile that captured that pupil's learning as they moved from broad general education into senior phase. But the pupil had responsibility for that. That really, we could build on that as a young person leaves school. And that could then be seen as worth as they move into employment, or so that it's not just a personal statement that everybody knows the number of words and it becomes a mechanistic activity, yeah. That you can really capture the richness of the school experience. But we need to make sure that we do that, that it's not bureaucratic and it then doesn't just become tokenistic. So I think we have to try to make sure that we capture the flavour of a young person's journey in school. And if we can use that, the young person can then use it as they move forward as well.
Thank you. And finally, Matt Ratter.
Thank you. I'll be brief. I think the point around capturing attainment for 3 to 18 is important. So for me, Curriculum for Excellence attainment in primary would be one of the sort of key set around that dashboard, if you like. Colleagues have mentioned some of the other points. I wonder whether there's a kind of discussion we just need to have as a country around. I mean, I welcome the new approach around the core plus. So certain ones that we agree that are absolutely important, and I guess that's the discussion that needs to be had. What goes into that core set, and then which of those beyond that in terms of achievement or the questions around health and well-being are sitting in the plus, where there are good systems at a local level or at a school level, but they're not necessarily reported all the way up to a Scottish Government level. And I guess that's probably some of that debate, and it probably brings us into the sort of some of the recommendations that are sitting in sort of Kem Muir's report that's been recently published.
Very helpful. No further questions. Giving a really helpful evidence. Thank you all for it.
Thank you, Bob Doris. And that brings us to the end of this part of our meeting. I'd like to thank Ruth Binks, Gerry Lyons, Tony McDade and Mark Ratter for their invaluable help to the committee in the pursuit of our inquiry, and wish you all a pleasant rest of the day. And at this point, we'll have a short suspension to allow our witnesses to leave the committee room. Thank you. Welcome back. The next on our agenda is consideration of public petitions. And we're first going to consider PE 1548, National Guidance on Restraint and Seclusion in Schools, lodged by Beth Morrison. This petition is calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to 1. Introduce national guidance on the use of restraint and seclusion in all schools. This guidance should support the principles of last resort, where it is deemed necessary. Restraint should be the minimum required to deal with the agreed risk for the minimum amount of time. Appropriate supervision of the child at all times, including during timeout or seclusion. Reducing the use of solitary exclusion and limiting the time it is used for example, maximum time limits. No use of restraints that are cruel, humiliating, painful and unnecessary or not in line with trained techniques. Accountability of teaching and support staff for their actions. This should include recording every incident leading to the use of seclusion or restraint and monitoring of this by the local authority. Regular training for staff in how to avoid the use of restraint and where restraint is unavoidable. Training in appropriate restraint techniques by the British Institute of Learning Disability accredited providers and no use of restraint by untrained staff. The second point of the petitioner's petition is to appoint a specific agency, either Education Scotland or possibly the Care Inspectorate, to monitor the support and care given in non-educational areas, including the evaluation of the use of restraint and seclusion of children with special needs in local authority, voluntary sector or private special schools. So our papers outline the work undertaken on the petition by both the Public Petitions Committee and the Session 5 Education and Skills Committee. In December 2019, the Deputy First Minister and then Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills confirmed that, and I quote, the Scottish Government will produce new national guidance that will provide a clear human rights-based policy on physical intervention and seclusion in Scottish schools, end of quote. A working group whose membership included the petitioner was established in early 2020 to develop and agree the new guidance, and although progress was delayed by the pandemic, in correspondence dated the 16th of February 2021, the Deputy First Minister indicated that the guidance would be finalised later in 2021. But as yet, this guidance has not been published. Can I ask members for any comments on the petition? Yes, Graeme Day.
Thank you, Convener. I should acknowledge that the petitioner is a constituent of mine. I very much commend her doggedness in this area and the constructive suggestions she's brought forward. We wouldn't be at this progress stage without that. Clearly, COVID has understandably intervened in the progress of this. I think it would be appropriate to write to the Cabinet Secretary seeking an understanding of where matters rest at the moment.
Yeah, and perhaps to ask for some timescales in terms of when we can expect the guidance that was developed by the working group. Yes, Ruth Maguire.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I think this is a really important topic, and I would agree with Graeme Day and yourself that in the first instance we should write to the Cabinet Secretary and ask for an update on when we will see that human rights-based policy and guidance. I think it's important for pupils, parents and indeed teachers. So.
Thank you. Are there any other comments? Everyone has agreed. So we're agreed that to write to the Cabinet Secretary to ask for an update on anticipated timescales for the guidance being developed by the working group. We're content with that, yes? We're content. Next petition is PE 1668, Improve Literacy Standards in Schools Through Research-Informed Reading Instructions, lodged by Anne Glenny. The petition is urging the Scottish Government to 1. Provide national guidance, support and professional learning for teachers in research-informed reading instruction, specifically systemic synthetic phonics. And 2. Ensure teacher training instructions, train new teachers in research-informed reading instruction, specifically systemic synthetic phonics. Now, our papers provide an outline of the action taken by the Public Petitions Committee and the Education and Skills Committee during Session 5 on this petition. The Session 5 Education and Skills Committee was undertaking an inquiry into initial teacher education and the early phase of teaching. Ahead of the formal evidence sessions for this inquiry, the committee agreed to take evidence from the petitioner to allow the broader issues raised by the petition to be explored, and for the session to include a focus on any issues that could inform the inquiry. The session set for the 18th of March 2020 did not take place as a result of the COVID pandemic, and the committee was unable to restart its inquiry on ITE owing to other work it undertook scrutinising the response to the pandemic. Do members have any comments on this petition? Yes, Deputy Convener.
I suppose from an educationalist point of view, I think that you need to consider this very carefully. Directing methodology and pedagogy is a tricky area, and that, from what I can see, that's what this is asking for us to go down a certain route. Over 30 years, I have taught synthetic phonics, but I've also taught the other ones, and at the moment, what they're trying to do in teaching initial education, whether they're doing it well enough or not, I'm not commenting, but it is to actually use a variety of those approaches. There are flaws to synthetic phonics, which is a technical thing, because it doesn't... there's sort of issues about pronunciation, there's issues about sort of neurodiversity and how those kids come into it. It doesn't solve the issue of dyslexia, and I'm wondering if that's all behind this. I mean, obviously I wasn't there at the previous session, but that, all of that has come to me. So I'm just, as much as I would love to get stuck into this, yeah, I'm just wondering what our role is. Is our role to be directing the way that we teach reading and rolling that out? Because that's what this is looking for, and I'm not sure that is our role. So,
sure, politicians should be involved. Yeah, I know. Any other comments? Thank you for that, Kokab. Stephanie.
Thank you, Convener. I was just going to agree and say that, you know, mandating local authorities, head teachers and teachers to teach in a specific way is quite concerning. I do have neurodiverse children myself too there, and it's that wider... That having that wider range of options to actually be able to work with what is going to be best for particular children. So it's about being able to work with children as individuals. Thanks.
So, yes, Michael.
Thanks, Convener. I'm conscious that we have received some evidence, I think, through the Ken Muir report around initial teacher education and discussions around that, that perhaps the reforms that were put in place almost a generation ago and that they have been replicated elsewhere, and we've not kept up to date on that. So I think, wonder whether maybe later in the session, I know we've got a very full work programme for the next year at least, I think, but perhaps later in the session it might be something that we would return to, given that after we've been through the legislative process, and maybe the petition would be, or at least the subjects dealt with in the petition might be addressed in a future inquiry on that basis. I know that that's not something we see on the immediate horizon, but I'm sure it would come up if there was another discussion about initial teacher education, which I think the committee may wish to do at some point. I certainly think there would be grounds to do so.
I think it's only fair to say, though, that in terms of expectations of the petitioner, we're not going to get to this specific aspect of education policy any time that I can see, in a year at least, because of the nature of the inquiries we've got underway, the Ken Muir stuff you've mentioned, and then on top of that we've got a growing number of legislative requirements which will take up our time as well. Does anyone want to make any further? Yes, Ruth.
I just, notwithstanding, you know, our obvious interest in initial teacher training, I wonder with this petition if, you know, based on what I suppose in particular COCAB Stewart's laid out there, that the right thing to do might be to actually close the petition.
Right, Graham, did you want to come in? No. Any other comments? Bob Doris.
Just briefly, I mean, if what Michael Marr's suggestion is that if at some point during the lifetime of our parliamentary session this committee is looking at a body of work, or this could be embedded as part of another inquiry that's ongoing, I think that's what the last committee had agreed they would do, and they found the opportunity
Obviously, we don't have the opportunity in this session. I suppose never say never is the point, but Mr. Mara is making. But the point the convener is making is, but given a false expectation, this might happen anytime soon. So I would agree that we should close the petition, but our knowledge of the petitioner's wider issues that they would seek to have raised doesn't disappear with the closure of the petition. And if there is another inquiry that happens that we can tack these questions onto, by all means. But at this stage, rather than have it drag on without being able to fulfil the petitioner's expectations, I would agree closing is probably the best thing to do.
Yeah, I tend to agree with what you said. I'll bring Michael back in a minute. But I think, to be fair to the petitioner, we're not likely to get to this in the immediate... I can't completely see over the brow of the hill, but I really don't see us getting into this policy area in the work of the committee over the next year at least. And therefore, I think the best thing to do is to be completely on the level and say we should close the petition, but should we get to the subject of initial teacher education, that we obviously would have an institutional memory of this petition and revisit it at that time. But I'll turn to Michael.
I'm content with that, convener. I think that sounds like the reasonable approach, but the committee is pretty clear.
Right. Well, are we content to close this particular petition? Thank you. We are content. Our next petition is on our agenda is PE1692, Inquiry into the Human Rights Impact of GRFIC Policy and Data Processing. I'm not a great fan of all these acronyms, I've got to say. I have to keep reminding myself what they all stand for. And this petition was lodged by Leslie Scott and Alison Prius on behalf of Times Trust and Scottish Home Education Forum. The petition is calling on the Scottish Government to initiate an independent public inquiry into the impact on human rights of the routine gathering and sharing of citizens' personal information on which its Getting It Right for Every Child, GRFIC, policy relies. Our papers explain that in January 2020, the Deputy First Minister and the then Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills explained that his officials were in the early stages of developing a package of products based on shared principles around how services should handle sensitive personal information to ensure that children, young people and their parents could be assured that their rights are being respected. At that time, the Deputy First Minister expected to publish these materials at the end of 2020. However, progress was delayed by the pandemic. Responding to a request for an update, the Deputy First Minister indicated in February 2021 that the guidance would be finalised later in 2021. As yet, this guidance has not been published. So can I ask members on their comments? I mean, clearly, although I'm not a fan of acronyms, the subject matter of personal data is a very much a critical issue in the minds of many people, including the petitioner. Who would like to make any comment on this? Yes, Michael.
I thought there was a clear direction of travel from the government in terms of their intent to respond. I think it would be reasonable to write to the government and ask what progress has been made on that. We understand the delays, but if they're going to make a response, it would be good to see it.
Yes. I think I can see lots of nodding heads. So are we content to write to the Cabinet Secretary and ask for an update on the timescales? Because clearly they need to be updated. Yes, we're all agreed. And our last petition being considered today is PE1747, Adequate Funding to Support Children with Additional Support Needs in All Scottish Schools, lodged by Alison Thompson. The petition is calling for the Scottish Government to provide adequate funding to support children with additional support needs in all Scottish schools, primary, secondary and special. Our papers outline the action taken on the petition by the Session 5 Public Petitions and its decision to refer the petition to the Education and Skills Committee. In its legacy report, the Session 5 Committee explained that it did undertake work on the additional support for learning following referral of petition PE1747, including taking evidence from Angela Morgan on her additional support for learning review report at its 18 November 2020 meeting, and looking at additional support needs as part of its pre-budget scrutiny. However, the committee stated that given time constraints, it was unable to fully consider the petition. Can I ask members for any comments on the petition? Michael.
Thanks, convener. I mean, I think this is a subject that comes up on a week-by-week basis in our committee. It came up again today you know, and the evidence we received regarding the attainment challenge, I think it's an underlying issue in the performance of our education system across Scotland, and you know, pertaining to some of the most vulnerable young people. I think that it would be good to see this more firmly on our work programme in the foreseeable future, given how often it comes up and the representations that I have to say, as a member. I think that this is something that should come more to the fore in our work programme, and if we can find space for that. I do recognise that that is a busy work programme and that we have to try and find the space to do it, but it is a recurring theme week by week in all the evidence I think that we receive, that this is a particular challenge for local authorities and for families. So I would be keen that we try and find some space for it. I recognise that may not be in the coming weeks, but how we deal with that I would take suggestions on, but I would be very keen to see us do something about this.
Okay, well, that's a very clear position. I mean, to some extent, this is an issue as a silver thread that runs through so many other different issues that we consider as part of our work programme. So it's not completely out there as an issue, as you've rightly pointed out. It's a consideration that has, you know, kept coming back up in terms of the committee and its work. Co-Cap Stewart.
I do agree with what you're saying. I do think it's important, though, we've been taking evidence about COVID. And again, just a view from inside the profession, additional support needs, that is a term that is very specific, and it does cover either not yet, you know, not diagnosed yet, or diagnosed difficulties and barriers to learning. So the evidence that we've been taking, and yes, additional needs has come up time and time again, but that has been needs, I think, my opinion, based on sort of like, you know, people suffering, young children suffering because of COVID. So they are two different things. We have to remember that. I'm just saying to you, you know, I don't disagree with what you're saying. I'm just correcting an idea in your head. You cannot conflate the two. There are now also experts that are starting to put in, for instance, parents are saying, I think my child is autistic and I want them assessed for that. Whereas actually, what the early years in particular are finding is that the professionals are saying, actually, in our professional opinion, they're not hitting those markers. It's because they have suffered due to lack of stimulus, and they actually need a bit of speech and language therapy. Right? So that's, I hope that gives you an example of there is a difference. So with this is concerning additional support needs as per, you know, the legislation and those quite tight parameters. So it's just to put that.
Come to Graham first and then come back to you, Michael.
Perhaps a question, convener, as much as an observation. I totally get Michael's point about the representations that we have as members. We might disagree about the extent to which responsibility for this lies with local authorities as opposed to, you know, additional funding from the Scottish Government. I guess my question is, convener, what form would the committee looking at this take? Because I don't envisage, particularly given our workload, a specific inquiry into it. I'm just not clear how we would take this forward. That's not to say that we shouldn't, but I think we need to have at least an idea of what form our interest in this would take before we could come to a decision as to what to do.
Well, as much as anything else, just to directly answer that, as much as anything else, this is about funding. So, I mean, we've got a budget cycle coming up again. But almost as soon as we get back from the summer, we could consider this particular issue in the context of our pre-budget scrutiny. For example, it's a pretty fair comment, it's a pretty fair issue to address as a committee with witnesses, including the Cabinet Secretary, in the course of that process. We could keep the petition open to take us to that point and then possibly review it again. Does that answer your...
With respect, suggest that we fundamentally accept that this is an issue of national government funding. I'm not sure that I entirely agree with that.
Well, the government does have the, as you well know, as a former minister, the government does have the capacity to bring fence funds for certain things that they pass along to local government. They do that without making a party, a political party. They do that rather deftly, this particular government. So I think it is something that the government could very much do. So I'll come back to Michael and then back to Coca.
Partly to give the deputy convener a reassurance that I'm not confused as to the picture I have in my mind in terms of the evidence we've received. The additional support needs issues have come up in the COVID context, but they've come up in a variety of other contexts. For instance, the institutional reviews that we're looking at talking about Education Scotland, they've come up in the evidence there. They came up again in the evidence today. I think it's actually something, as the convener rightly put, it's a silver thread that's running through much of the evidence we've seen in the different work of this committee over the last year. So it's not particular to COVID, although there has been a clear impact from COVID on young people from additional support needs. That brings me to, I think, the point is, I would see this in a broader context. I think actually we do need to look at it, and the funding of this and how the funding is allocated is one part of that question. It's clear, implementation of the Morgan Review, how appropriately has that been done? Are we maintaining that? Are we meeting the kind of the aspirations that were set out there? So that a broader inquiry in that, I think, would be very appropriate. It's something that I hear all the time, and I think there's a real need for it.
Thank you.
Beg
your pardon. Cole Cubs. Yes,
you
are.
I have no difficulty with just picking up from where the previous committee was, because they were going to consider it. That was their next step, was to consider it as part of the pre-budget scrutiny. So I don't have an issue with that.
All right. That's helpful. Thank you very much. Bob Doris, and then Ruth.
Crikey, convener, I hope this is a helpful contribution. I think we're all agreed that we'll keep the petition open, but I think we're in danger of rehearsing what our discussions may be during our work programme chat.
Yes.
And I think there'll be as much or little work on this as we deem appropriate, and we will reflect on how we can best take that forward. Budget scrutiny would seem an obvious hook to hang it on to, but we'll all want to reflect on that. If what we're just saying for the moment is we won't close the petition, that's what we're saying. And we could pick up the cudgels again at our work programme.
Absolutely. The cudgels will still be there to be picked up. Ruth?
Yeah. I think hearing, obviously there is a great deal of interest in this. It's an important topic, but I wonder if maybe one of our private business planning discussions is the place to sort of fully thrash out, if you like, where it's going to go. I would agree with keeping it open, but I think we want to, with a full work programme, we want to be sure we give this the attention it deserves. Does it fit into something else, or does it need something separate? Can we give it, the proper attention it deserves. So I would propose that the next time we're having our we keep it open, and the next time that we're having those discussions in private, that we go into that there.
Okay, Ruth has summed up things pretty nicely there. Co-cab?
Yeah, Ruth said exactly what I was going to say. Thank you for that, because it was the bit about, I have no issue with it, but I was mindful of the impact on our work programme and what would we give up in order to give this justice as well, because it does deserve justice. I agree with...
It's a fair point. But I think Ruth's summary captures, I think, the sentiment, I think, of everyone that has spoken. Stephanie, do you want to add something?
Yeah, not disagreeing with Ruth at all. Absolutely bang on the money there, I think. Just to highlight as well, there is the fact that we've got over 30% of our children do have additional support needs. So just to actually mention that in the discussion, but absolutely agree with Ruth too.
Good point.
So it affects so many parents and so many families.
Which highlights the concerns of the petitioner and so it does, as you say, it's highlighted by the concern of the petitioner, which, of course, is why we're having this discussion. So I think we have decided to keep the petition open and to consider further this matter at a future discussion on our work programme. Thank you for that. Are we content with that outcome? Yes, we're content. And that brings the public part of today's meeting to an end. I will now suspend the meeting, and can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams in a few minutes? Well, actually, I think maybe there isn't anyone to convene when I come to think of it. But anyway, this will allow us to consider our final items in private. And for those of you who are watching our proceedings, a very good morning.